Hello and welcome, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us for another episode of A New Go of New Home Sales. I'm your host, Anya Christianthan, and I'm very excited to introduce my guest for today. He is a national award-winning sales manager, I should say, director of sales and marketing, Taylor Humphrey at Pacesetter Homes. So welcome to the show. I'm so excited to have you and congratulations on your win.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm definitely humbled to be here. Everybody knows exactly who you are. So to get to be able to be on this is awesome. So thank you for the invite.
Well, I knew you before you were the national award.
That's right. Guess what? I'm still the same guy.
Everybody knew you before that. So don't sell yourself short here. So I would love for our listeners to get to know you a little bit, if you don't mind. Giving us an overview of what your career has been. How did you get into new home sales arena? And I know you have quite a long career, despite you looking very young. And tell us all about it.
thank you. So I'll say that I grew up around the business. My grandfather sold homes for 25 years in Houston. And I've always had a love for it. I mean, grew up very poor and we didn't have money after church on Sundays. So we'd go to Dairy Queen and then we'd go walk model homes and just always been around it. Grew up sweeping homes for him. Actually, my mom and I cleaned model homes. You know, like I said, grew up very poor. And so I just loved being around it. I love that environment. And I guess most stories, they start with a girl, right? So prior to getting into residential construction, I worked for a company that some may know, Lovesac, which is like the giant beanbags and just an incredible company. If you ever get a chance to look up the leader, Sean Nelson, he's the owner. He's fantastic. Just a wonderful, wonderful leader. I learned so much from him. But so I was traveling around the country doing that, building their retail stores, and met a girl here in Dallas. And I was like, man, I got to do something that is similar, but where I'm not traveling. And so I was like, man, I love residential construction. And company here in Dallas took a chance on a 22-year-old that had never built a house before. And that was 17 years ago. Day two, I was able to meet our president and I said, that's what I want to do. So I'm now 17 years in. I'm still focused on that goal. I want to be a division president. But my philosophy on it is I don't ever want to be in a position where I'm managing somebody that I've never done their job before, right? So I built homes for that company and ultimately ended up being one of the guys that you came and you trained with as you started with that company. And I went to my boss at that time and said, hey, I want to be in sales, because I thought that was the next step. Like, hey, I've done construction. I've done it at a high level. Now I want to move to the sales side because I don't want to ever manage salespeople with no skins on the wall, right? Having never negotiated a deal for a $1 million home, if you've never sat in that and sat across from somebody negotiating that, you just don't get it, you know? So he said, I had a newborn baby, and he said, hey, if you want to do it. But by the time she hits kindergarten, you got to be in that role. And I took him for it. And long story short, I was blessed enough to run across a mentor who took a chance on me, and he put me over sales and construction for a home builder. And I've been in management ever since. I'm getting close to 10 years in that management role. So it's wonderful.
Wow. Amazing. So I love that you've done all the jobs. So you've done the construction, you've done the sales, you've done the sales training, and now the management. So because you're so right, it's very difficult to relate to somebody and understand what they're going through unless you have done that job. And yeah, it can look very different, especially between salespeople and construction people. Sometimes there can be tension because sales get all the love and all the glory and all the money, it seems like, right? But construction guys don't understand that, hey, you know, on the weekends when they're out, you know, attending birthday parties and doing whatever, the salespeople are in the model home, yeah, giving up their life for the job. So yeah, it's definitely gives you a very, very interesting perspective with that. So are you in the Dallas area now?
Yeah, I am. We're out of McKinney, and we're all over the Metroplex. So should be around 350, 400 homes in this next coming year and a half. But yeah, Pacesetter is a wonderful company. And just been blessed to be here and to grow this team. But getting back to the sales and construction is, having been in each one of those departments, purchasing land, construction, sales, marketing, what I feel like I have the ability to do is, because I've been in each one of those roles or have experience in it, is everybody comes in and they know like their portion of the machine, right? They're cog in the overall machine, and everybody plays a part, but they don't understand basically how they hand it off, right? And how they can set up the next person, for success. And so I'm a huge culture guy, and that's my biggest focus, is how do we get the person that's in the starts department just as bought in as the person that's in the field, and how do we get them taking care of their customers so they set up that person that is the frontline sales and construction, for success, but then also get the reward of how do we get that person going, man, awesome, we close, 20 houses this week, and just as excited. So that's where I spend a lot of my time, is really on that culture and taking down those silos that we all know, especially at the bigger companies, definitely exist.
Yeah. And I think from the customer perspective, there's nothing better when they feel that every member of the team is on the same mission. And it really shows when you do have that ingrained in the culture. So I love that. So Taylor, I'd love to learn a little bit more about Pacesetter. So tell us, what kind of homes do you guys build? What markets are you in? And what the business has been like for you over the last year or so?
Yeah. So, we have this, it's hard to explain. We're like a big company. It's a $2 billion company. We're the largest builder in Canada. We do residential construction. We're developers, we're framers, sheetrockers. I mean, it's a huge company, but it's a family-owned business, right? So Kevin Vann, who's one of our great leader, he's a family guy, and man, just super approachable. And so we have a lot of the power, a lot of the push that, these bigger companies have. But it's with, a privately held kind of mentality. So it's very much like take care of the customer. And then here locally, there's three of us that run it. Me and myself. That's one person. No, I'm just kidding. But it's Blake Friesenhahn and then Eric Zimmerman. And really with the culture, it starts from the top. And we do it together, and we push each other to try and make it just that much better. And I think it shows through our teams. But as far as like what we build, we have anything from, entry level where we're doing actually like duplexes. They're kind of townhomes, but they're duplexes, high architectural detail, all the way up to, we're in the sevens and eights and rock wall, and we've got our executive series. But our biggest thing is choice, especially in the last couple of years, so many builders have gone down to just packages or like I like to say, because I have a little kid, you get what you get and don't pitch a fit. Here's your price and move on in. We want to put choice, so if you and I buy the same home, even if it's, like say a $400,000 home or $350,000 home, within our standard specifications, we're going to be able to have enough choice where I don't have to necessarily do upgrades. Now, you can upgrade, we want you to, so that you can personalize it, make it your own. But overall, our biggest thing is choice. So high architectural detail and choice.
Love that. And we know from the latest Zillow study that they just released is that more people want to buy new construction for that customization, to make it their own and not just to buy a new home for the sake of buying a new home. And the more time we spend at home post pandemic, it seems like, the home has always been obviously the most important place in the world. But now that we spend even more time there, it makes sense that people do want to customize that.
Yeah.
So what has the market has been for you like in Dallas area? So obviously so the time of this recording, we're just in the beginning of April. So what are you seeing?
You know, it's been interesting. I can tell you what we prepared for, and then I can tell you what we're seeing in the market. You know, we prepared for just like everybody else, you know, hey, rates are going up. And so that must mean, hey, demand is going to certainly go down. We haven't seen that. We saw a slowdown for sure at the end of the year. And then it slowly started to pick up. And I have the pleasure of being in a round table where I talk to kind of my cohorts from around the country. And I remember at the beginning of January, they're talking like, hey, traffic has been up, web traffic has been up, sales are up. And me and my counterpart in Austin were talking. I'm like, I'm not seeing it. And then it was like overnight, traffic doubled. Then it tripled. Then it quadrupled, right? Just in the last six or eight weeks. And so, I mean, it is buying season and the customers are going, hey, you know, and they're saying, hey, we need homes. And like I'm telling my sales team, the rates are the rates. You know, stop apologizing for it. Those of us that have been in the business for a while, they know that 2%, 3%, yeah, that was fantastic. We may never see that again, right? The likelihood of that is low, but that 4 to 6, now up into the 7s, that's typically normal, you know? So at least for our generation and our buyers, they're showing that. And from a resale market, I don't know how, you know, it is around the country, but I'll say here in Dallas, people aren't moving. They're not moving because they refied and they're in those, like myself, I'm in a 2.25 15 year. I would love to build a new house. I'm not going anywhere because I love that payment, you know? Right. So because of that, new construction is the way to go. And that's good for us and good for the overall, you know, economy.
I'm glad to hear that. It seems that all over the country, things are picking up and even we've seen pricing of the home is going up, which, you know, so it's almost like, okay, so this is what experts are saying and this is what we're seeing in the real world, which sounds like the real world is certainly better than what the experts have predicted. So fingers crossed that we have a really great spring market followed by still hot summer. So Taylor, again, congratulations on your win at the Nationals, you know, for taking home Sam. So it's such a huge accomplishment. And you know what, when you said, I told him I wanted to be the division president, that makes sense to me. So I think that is definitely what separates successful people is that they know what they want. They know where they're going. And sometimes the road there does not look like a straight line. Sometimes it looks like a step forward, two steps back, you know, and then three steps forward and so on. But they always know where are they trying to go. So, and I know personally that you work for it. So if you guys have not met Taylor before, I've seen him all over. And anytime you see sales training, Jeff Shore, obviously, I always think about you. So tell us why you decide to invest in yourself and why did you decide to partner with Jeff? And how do you think that contributed to where you are today?
There's a lot to unpack there. So where to start? So number one, I grew up playing baseball. I've always been competitive, played all the way up into college. And then after that, I was a competitive triathlete for 13 years. And so I learned then, and we had a saying, and so if you've been around me long enough, you'll hear me say it is, you know, we don't go to a race to an Ironman and just show up, right? We made that decision a long time ago. And every day we built, and we called it building brick by brick, right? So even I'm now 17 years in, I have a goal every single day. I'm going to learn at least one thing that's going to put me closer to where I want to go. To that, like I said, day two of my career, I was like, that's the position that I'm going to be. Now, I don't know when that's going to happen, But I'll tell you, when I get there, I'll be ready, because every single day I made that decision to learn one thing so that whenever I'm there, there's no, not imposter syndrome, but basically the same thing. Like, no, it should be, I know those, you know, I know what I know because I poured in every day. And if you stick around me long enough, you'll know I'm hyper competitive. From 5 to 7 a.m. every day, I'm training. And so if you want to know the secret is I'm up before you and I'm thinking about my goals and what I want to do, and I'm training towards it, where it's physical or it's in this business, and I'm grinding every single morning. Because again, it goes back to the triathlons. If I got to a race and I did not do well, in my mind, it was because I took that one day off. I took that one day where I was like, you know what? I'm going to take it easy today. I don't ever want to get to that spot. I don't want to get to race day and go, if I just worked a little bit harder just on that one day. So I've pushed that forward into my career, where every day I'm working on it. Now, I will say, going to Jeff, if you don't have a mentor, get a mentor. I'm blessed that I do have mentors, but I'll tell you why I have mentors. I have mentors because I ask for it. So if you take anything from this talk, look, I'm, like I said, I'm, I feel like I'm an old man at this point, but from day one, if I found somebody that knew something about what I wanted to learn, I went to that person and I asked for it. Whether it's, I'll just say in my market, and these people that you would know, you know, whether it's Jeff, whether it's Chris Hartley, Cashin, whether it's Jeff Shore, these people are super smart people. Go to them and ask them if you want help. We all have been blessed with mentors, and we want to pass it on to somebody, and no one asks. Like, every single time I do one of these, I put out my phone number and I'm like, hey, if you want a mentorship, call me. You know how many times my phone rings? Zero. Because people don't ask for it, right? Okay, so how does Jeff help? So Jeff is exactly that. He's been a mentor, and he's somebody that I trust. Like, I don't follow people that I don't feel like I align with, I have to align with them morally, ethically, and then also as a driver. And actually, a lot of people don't know, he's more introverted than you would think. But as far as this business, that dude is on it. He knows what he's doing, and he wants to tell you, he wants to show you, he wants to help you, and he cares. He's a good guy. If you have the opportunity to go to his stuff, do it. If you have the opportunity to get into his round table, that was life-changing. I thought I was a great manager until I get around managers from around the country. It's just like a house. There's 1,000 different ways to build a house. There's 1,000 different ways to be a manager, and you got to find your voice. And between the people in that group and Jeff, you find your voice. And then kind of continuing on the mentors, from that round table, we call ourselves the Fantastic Five. There's five of us on a group text. We're all around the country, and we talk nonstop every day. A lot of those, the guys are on the East Coast. I'm up at 5 a.m. anyways. They're texting at 6 o'clock. This is what I'm going to do today. You know, bouncing ideas off of each other. And that's that whole iron sharpens iron, man. I mean, some incredible individuals of Jordan Brown, Mary Beth Barry, she's actually with Shore Consulting now, Jennifer Williams, and Craig Neal. I mean, these guys are some of the best, but I have the pleasure, because of the round table, to call them my friends, and we push each other to go to that next level. So there's another word of wisdom. Just, man, find a mentor and ask for it.
Love that. So you guys, a quick plug for Jeff's summit. So Tyler, you're going to be there this summer. It's going to be in Nashville, Tennessee, July. I forget the dates.
I think it's he's going to kill me. I think it's 15, July 19
something. But okay. So you guys, we do have a special deal for you as a listener of this podcast. You're not going to find a better deal than this. We have a buy one, get one deal. So if you want to join us at Jeff Shore Sales and Marketing Summit this year, I want you to go to anugosell.com/Jeff, and you'll be able to get that deal for a buy one ticket, get one free. So you can bring both sales and marketing to the summit, and make sure to use Anugo at checkout to get that deal. So I will be sure to include that in the show notes, because it's definitely going to be an incredible, incredible summit. And now this year, what they're doing different is that they're combining the sales and marketing. And as a director of sales and marketing, I would love to hear your take on that, because I think it's been such a long debate of, do we keep sales and marketing together? Is that a one position? Do we need a director of sales and a director of marketing? How do we work together? So talk to me about your role as far as sales and marketing goes, because they are separate, but yet they need to function together. So love your take on that.
Yeah. So real quick, July 25th through 27th in Nashville, just confirm that. Perfect. Yeah. So sales and marketing is that, and is so, it kind of rubs me the wrong way sometimes. I will say one more thing about the summit. I just think it's great to get around other people that are in your profession and network. I mean, some of the best conversations and things that I've spurred have spurred me on, it's just being around other people that are in your same spot. So from a, you know, sales management, from a marketing management, I mean, if you're dealing with something, you're not going to vent to your boss about, you know, something you're dealing with your sales team, and you're certainly not going to go to your team. So if you go to something like this, it's mentally so much or so good for you to get around people that know what you're going through, know what you're dealing with, and they've got a different take on everything, right? So get out from, you know, your office, get to something like this where you can network and again have people that pour into you and spur you on with different ideas. But going to the sales and marketing, man, I think marketing, 9 times out of 10, I feel like they get they get overlooked, right? It's easy for the salesperson to be like, hey, look at everything that I just sold. Well, that's the tip, right? How did we get all those people to you, right? They started way back here and they didn't know who you were at all, right? But so having somebody in that role that can understand the different funnels, you know, you go to a marketing summit and they'll talk about the sales funnel. Well, there's two funnels. There's the sales funnel that the salesperson has once they get to them, but then there's the last, we'll say 3 months before that buyer even got to you, that the marketing department was working so hard to get them through the door. And having somebody that can understand both of those and tinker so that things can get better and you can make sales, that's wonderful. Not everybody does that. And that's not a brag towards me. I'm just saying that, like, if you don't have a sales and marketing person, then you really got to focus on that relationship between sales and marketing and sit and look and go, hey, are we putting up barriers that shouldn't be there? So my marketing team is in every single one of my sales rallies so that they're understanding how we're trying to close deals, how we're training our sales team with, you know, with the 4-2 from Jeff Shore and vice versa. I mean, the sales department, I can't tell you how many times I've heard, oh, well, I just need more marketing. And I'm like, we're pouring a ton into getting them to you, but you just may not be aware. So, you know, communication is huge for that marketing team to say, this is what we're doing for you. And if the sales team feels equipped with that, they're just going to feel just all the more confident.
Yeah. Isn't that the worst thing in the world when a prospect walks through the door and says, hey, I heard about this deal that you're advertising, and the salesperson's like, what?
Yeah. Communicate with them. I mean, you know, I tell my sales team, you got to look at yourself as you work for Pacesetter, but you're your own brand. And so what are you doing to run your production team, which is, hey, are you pouring in and are you helping your construction team to run your production? Are you pouring into your marketing, right? What does your marketing look like? Is it just do you feel like it's just you going to realtor offices and stuff? Or are you connected with your office where they have all the money and all the budget to do those things? And are you guys talking about it? And the same thing with our marketing department. Hey, instead of just running something, did you talk to the person in the field to see what they feel like would be, you know, beneficial? So All that being said, is that communication and relationships between the different departments, apparently that's my whole theme for this conversation, because it's huge.
It's a great message. Hey, you know, it is. And, you know, not just for sales to understand what marketing is doing, so they're not clueless in front of prospects, but also for marketing, it's so important to understand sales. And I love that you have them in your sales rally, because, you know, unless you understand what kind of questions you're getting from your prospects, unless you understand what kind of objections you're hearing from your prospects, you can't put out effective marketing, because effective marketing needs to overcome all of those before they even step a foot into your door. And so when your marketing team is aware of what's going on the ground level with sales, what your salespeople are hearing, because your salespeople are obviously going to be able to tell marketing, hey, these are the kind of people I'm seeing through the door. These are the kind of questions I'm getting. These are the objections. This is what they're asking for. So your marketing team can really pivot their message and make sure it hits. And so I love that Jeff has partnered with none other than Molly Elkman from Group 2 Advertising, the genius behind the house that she built, book. And obviously, if you guys know Molly, you know that she is a branding guru and all things new home sales marketing. So I'm really excited that Jeff and Molly have partnered for the summer, for the event. And I can't wait to see what they're going to serve, because I know it's definitely going to be something really, really hot. Now, listening to you talk about your morning routine, I'm definitely thinking like, wow, I would A, not want to go up against you, and B, it would be really fun to compete against you, because you bring it and I love that fire. So can you talk to us about your morning routine? Because I'm always fascinated, especially, I know you said you have a younger child. So how does that fit into the whole routine? How do you manage that? What happens between 5 to 7? If you can kind of walk us through your typical day.
Yeah, it's a little different now that I'm not racing like I used to, but I will say I still try and protect that as much as possible. So like I said, from 5 to 7, that's my time. My girls don't get up until 7. And when I mean girls, I have an 11-year-old daughter, and then I've been married for 17 years. And little brag is I make them coffee and breakfast in bed every single day. And that's how I wake them up. But yeah, like I said, I wake up in the morning, I've got coffee, I spend some time, whether it's in the Word, if I'm a spiritual guy. And then I get after it, whether it's I ride, I run. I haven't been swimming as much as I used to. I used to swim on a team. And then I'm lifting. So you don't have to do those things. But I will tell you, if you can get up early before everybody else does, it gives you a head start. It gives you time for your mind to collect your thoughts. You don't feel rushed, especially you need to be doing 45 minutes of some activity a day that just puts you in a healthy, balanced mindset. If you're waking up and just hitting the road and going, especially from a manager standpoint, you don't feel like you're on your routine. I am a routine and schedules guy. Like everything is down to the minute. I think I told you when I started this, like, hey, I got to stop at this specific time, because I know where I'm going to need to do to get to the next one. It keeps me balanced. And the reason being is if I can put balance and structure around my life, then whenever my team, whether sales, marketing, whoever's coming to me, I'm not panicked, right? Because I know I've got all this other stuff handled and I'm taking care of it. Then when you come to me, I don't panic. As a leader, that's the last thing you want to do. You want to be safety. You want to be a sounding board, and you don't want to panic when they come. Because any leader can speak to this. If they see you, any leader or parent, how about that? If they see you panicked, they're going to panic even more, right? We've all had, if you've got little kids, you know, when they bump their knee as a little kid and you panicked, they started crying. It's the same concept. If you're like, it's fine, and you just move on, then they're like, oh, okay, this must be okay. That starts at 5 a.m. That starts with planning your day, and that starts with taking care of yourself, because if you don't, you're just going to burn out. So you have to spend a lot of time and effort on yourself. And so for me, I do it early in the morning before I know everybody's up, before I'm getting any emails again, because if you try and put it in at the end of your day, especially with new home sales, your phone's going to be blown up and you're not going to get it done. So knock it out first. If you haven't, a little easy read, if you haven't read Make Your Bed, that's an easy one. It's a quick, I think it's like 10 different things on organizational life, Colonel or Admiral. Anyways, he wrote a book, Make Your Bed. And it starts with achieving some quick goals early in the morning. It just puts you in the right set throughout the day.
Yeah, I'm definitely a big believer in making your bed in the morning. Yeah. So Taylor, I'd love to hear your perspective. So most of sales managers get promoted from the sales position, right? They were a great salesperson and now they got promoted to sales leader. And oftentimes we don't have any sort of training once you're promoted into that position. It's like, okay, good luck. So I know that you have been a member of Jeff's roundtable. So can you talk to us briefly about what that is and how can people find out more about that? Because that is something separate from the sales and marketing summit this summer.
Absolutely. But they run a great promotion for the summit. For the roundtable at the summit. And so I'll be there. Several of my cohorts will be at their roundtable section of the summit. If you come there, I don't want to overspeak for their discount, but I know there's always a discount if you do it actually at the summit. But, you know, one of the best things and one of the best takeaways that I had as a leader going into that was our very first one. It was fundamentals of management. But one of the easiest things that he did was we started with email, right? Like so many people use email as like their text message. And you end up spending so much time behind your desk and not in front of your people. And he's got a huge focus on that. All right. Like his first thing that he said in the first meeting was, how do you want to be fired? Right? What is your main focus? Are you answering emails? Are you focusing on lead conversion? And man, when he said that, it just blew my mind. But anyways, I cannot speak higher enough for getting into that group, getting around sales leaders that are just like you. And there's varying levels. We had people that were in marketing that had not been promoted to a sales leader, but they were gonna be. And then we also had people that had just been promoted. And then there were people like myself that were, you know, like I said, close to a decade of sales leadership and getting around that. And man, I will tell you emotionally from a friendship, from a career wise, like it's been one of the best things that's happened to my career and really to my life. I have some of my best friends that I'll have for the rest of my life that came straight from the round table. And ultimately now I'm doing the alumni. So it's the alumni circle, which after you've gone through the round table, you can continue and get in that. And that just takes it to a whole nother level. But it's been wonderful.
Love that. So you guys see, Taylor has been in sales management role for close to a decade, and yet he keeps going. He keeps doing things to improve. To no wonder you were the winner this past nationals. So kudos to you. Huge congratulations. Very well deserved. And speaking of mentorship, are you involved with NAHB YPs, the Young Professionals, by chance?
I'm involved with the young professionals here in Dallas, but not national.
I'm a national. Okay. Well, I'm going to get you involved because that is one of our initiatives is the mentorship program, because as new YPs join the NAHB Nation, we'd love for them to find a place with a mentor who can show them the way, show them around, show them the ropes. So I guarantee you somebody is going to take you up on that now. So
love that. I love that.
And Tyler, as we wrap things up here, is there anything that I did not ask you that you'd like our listeners to know?
Yeah, so it kind of goes back to what you were just saying as far as like getting stagnant and not pushing yourself and not being intentional, right? So one of my greatest fears is quicksand. And that just means getting complacent, you know, whether it's in sales. There's always salespeople that they're like, hey, I made this much this year and I'm happy with it. And then there's a group that's like, hey, I want to take it to the next level. For me, I don't ever want to be just stuck and not continuing to push and challenge myself. So, you know, that's kind of the core on what I was saying, where I'm constantly just looking like what's the next step? How can I learn? And don't just think it's from somebody that's been doing it a lot longer. It could be somebody that's brand new, right? So something I always say to my team is, I don't care if you've been doing it for 10 years. I don't care if you've been doing it for 6 months, right? There's a right way and a wrong way to do it, right? And so you may need to reevaluate and go, yeah, I've been doing it for 10 years, but maybe that's not the way that we need to do it anymore, right? Maybe I should listen to this guy that's brand new, that's got a fresh set. So just keep your eyes and ears open and always, always be learning.
Love that. And so Tyler, if somebody wants to connect with you personally and take you up on that mentorship, is there a place on social media where do you hang out, or what's the best place to get in touch with you?
The best place, I'm always on LinkedIn. I think that's, like I said, I love what we do. I'll never do anything different. So I'm always on LinkedIn. You can find me there. I'm also on Facebook. My Facebook is almost solely for work. My wife will tag me in things from time to time, but it's usually me bragging on my team. And then I am on Instagram. So, and both of those are thumphrey00. And then there's LinkedIn, which is pretty straightforward. So connect with me, ask questions. You got anything? I'm just always looking for people that are hungry for this business, and any way I can help, I'm happy to do so.
Love that. So I will be sure to link all that information in the show notes. And again, you guys, if you want to see Tyler and I this summer in Nashville, Tennessee, July 25th through 27th, be sure to join us. Get that buy one, get one BOGO deal. You're not going to get a better deal for the summit by going to anugocell.com/Jeff and use Anugo at checkout to save big time. So you can definitely bring your sales and marketing team so they can work together. So Tyler, thank you so much for being on the show today. It's been such a pleasure to get to know you a little bit more. I'm sure our listeners will feel inspired by your story, and you're definitely giving them something to work towards. So you guys, I hope if anything you take away from today is set your goals, set them high, and no matter where you are, just keep going, keep working towards that, a step at a time, do whatever you can every single day to learn something new. So thank you, Tyler, and I look forward to seeing you this summer.
Thank you for having me.